if everyone could take a seat. We're running a few minutes late already, so we're about ready to begin. We are, so we're nearing the end. It's been a wonderful weekend, I think. Is this your first Karachi public event?
This is my first Karachi public event.
Welcome to Karachi.
Yeah, I'm a neophyte.
There's a big Karachi welcome. So I first heard of Danial Moinuddin a few years ago when my friend, the writer Nadeem Aslam, called me up and he said, "Who's this Danial Moinuddin?" And I said, "What are you talking about?" And he said, "Haven't you read The New Yorker?" And within about 48 hours, the number of people who were sort of calling me, who I was running into, who were saying, "Who is this Danial Moinuddin?" Because Danial had a story in The New Yorker, and some of you may already know this, some may not. There is no more prized literary real estate in, certainly in America, possibly in the English language publishing world, than The New Yorker. There are many writers who have a very long and distinguished publishing history and never get into The New Yorker. And there was this guy who didn't even have a book, and didn't have, as far as anyone knew, a book contract, and he had somehow landed himself in The New Yorker with an amazing story, which everyone I know sort of fell in love with, about an electrician called Nawabuddin. And so it was really sort of, you know, it was one of those moments where this sort of buzz went around. Who's this guy? When is there a book coming out? And I had a slightly embarrassing moment, which was a friend of mine who's editor-in-chief of Random House India emailed me with the question I kept hearing, she said, "What do you know about, do you know anything about Danial Moinuddin?" By now, I had spoken to my mother and forwarded the story to him, and so I sort of sent back this very desi kind of, you know, my grandfather knew his grandfather and my mother, da 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 da. And she wrote back and she said, "That's nice, dear. What's his email address?" So it was one of the more foolish moments of my life. But anyway, a book did appear, In Other Rooms, Other Wonders, and went on to be, I think, one of the most talked about debuts in recent times, shortlisted or won pretty much every prize that a collection of short stories can be up for, including the National Book Award and the Pulitzer. It won the Story Award.
Story Prize.
The Commonwealth Writers' Prize for first book and a whole host of others. And Danial is going to afford us a rare privilege, I think, which is to read something which hasn't been published.
Right.
So if you want to explain what...
Yeah. I'm going to stand up, if that thing works.
Hello.
Yeah, good. I have a whole file. Oops. I have a whole file on my computer, which I have titled Outtakes and Bloopers. And this is the pieces of stories that, for one reason or another, didn't make it into the... this book, but it concerns sort of the same characters. And at some point, I'm supposedly going to finish these stories and publish them. So this is taken from that file, and the story is about this, it's somewhat autobiographical, but not really, in that it's about if you don't know my history, I went to college in America and then came back here and took over my father's farm. And sort of was very much green behind the ears, or whatever they call it, when I showed up and didn't really know anything. And this story is sort of describing this young guy named Azmat has just showed up at this farm, and the farm is controlled by the munchies, the managers. And these guys are running rings around him and making a fool of him. So this is sort of describing his coming to the realization that he's completely out of his depth. Which I also came to at some point. And with no further ado, so in this sort of taken from the middle of the book, increasingly it dawned upon Azmat that the farm had become unmanageable, the situation much worse than he had suspected when he first moved there. During the Bhutto land reforms 10 years earlier, Salim is the head munchi. During the Bhutto land reforms 10 years earlier, Salim had convinced his father, the father of this guy, had convinced K.K. Gurmani, Azmat's father, legally to transfer some property into the names of others so that family members wouldn't hold more land than the anticipated ceilings. The old man, who no longer traveled, not even to the farm, gave Salim unlimited powers of attorney, permitting him to arrange the transfers. Many nominees were members of Salim's extended family or the families of other junior managers. And now, when Azmat tried to reverse the transfers, he found innumerable obstacles in his way. The relevant portions of the official land records were reported to have been eaten by termites, and the land records in the Gurmani farm office had supposedly been destroyed and thrown away when a water pipe broke. One day, when they were walking through the fields of newly planted emerald wheat, Azmat turned to Salim. "How much land do you own, Manager Sahib?" "Oh, a few acres, enough to give me fodder for my buffaloes." Azmat stopped and looked Salim in the face. "And where is your land?" "Let's put it this way. Wherever you have land, I also hold something. A bit here and a bit there." I'll actually translate this for you into Punjabi, because this actually happened, and it was very funny. I said to him, "Choi saab, tadi zameen kithe?" He said, "Mia saab, is tarah samajh lo, jithe tadi, utthe naal sadi bhi hoegi." "And how did you get this land?" "What do you think?" He permitted himself to show annoyance. "I bought some of it, as you know, from your father. May you rest in peace. I sold land that my family owned in Laya. Please send somebody to check on it." Of course, Salim stole water and fertilizer and labor and tractor hours from the Gurmani farm. Azmat guessed that he acquired some of his holdings by removing the land from the farm ledgers, transferring it into his children's names, and getting the revenue officials to backdate the transfers into the miasma of the past. Azmat could do nothing. He asked the accountant to make a list of all his lands, but this showed him holding just 800 acres and almost nothing near the city, where the land would be most valuable. There must be more. He decided to visit the office of the Tehsildar, the land revenue officer in Khanpur, keeping up with Salim the pretense that they together wished to solve the problem. The Tehsildar, the second most important revenue official in Khanpur after the assistant commissioner, had his offices in a crumbling British-era building near the old city, made of bricks with deep verandas and archways. Onto this had been appended strangely incongruous additions, including a tin-roofed portico painted with glossy blue and white stripes, sheltering the Tehsildar's official jeep. Azmat drove in under an old peepal tree, stopped the car, and hopped out without turning off the engine, leaving the driver to park. Salim fell in behind him, and they walked up to the door, guarded by a peon wearing a dirty white uniform, somewhat like a sailor suit with brass buttons. Azmat had never been to this office before. "Gurmani," he announced to the peon, "please tell the Tehsildar sahab." Salim leaned forward and whispered in Azmat's ear, "Go on in." In the room, six or seven men were sitting on a line of chairs arrayed in front of a large desk. Behind the desk sat the Tehsildar, a short Punjabi with very thick black hair parted at the side, wearing elaborate golden-framed glasses with the interlocking Chanel monogram on each side. His starched white shalwar were of a satiny cotton, and his gold cufflinks were matched for brilliance only by his gold pen, which lay on his desk in front of him, pinning down some papers. By contrast, the chairs were rickety and of cheap wood, the floors bare concrete and slippery with dust, and worst of all, a strong smell of urine escaped from a little toilet that had been built by walling off a corner of the room, the Tehsildar presumably being unwilling to enter the even more foul common latrines. The Tehsildar looked up owlishly, regarded Azmat, and continued speaking to one of the men arrayed in front of him. "So, he told that son of a bitch that judge or no judge, they were confiscating those videotapes." Azmat took one of the seats pushed against the wall, very aware that the other visitors were of a crude social class, hangers-on to government officials, penny lawyers, and various kinds of fixers. Already he regretted having come. Salim, with a friendly smile on his face, his teeth very white, stepped forward to the desk. The Tehsildar jumped up, and not content with shaking Salim's hand, walked around to the side of his desk and embraced him. "Assalamu alaikum, Chaudhary Sahib," said the Tehsildar. "But why have you come here? You should have called me and I would have waited upon you in Dunyapur." Still looking into Salim's face, he reached around on the table with his other hand, found the telephone, lifted the receiver and muttered to the steno to send tea. Chaudhary Salim beamed at the Tehsildar. The Tehsildar re-beamed at Chaudhary Salim. "Please, please, The Tehsildar motioned to the men sitting in front of the desk, who instantly vacated their seats. Azmat awkwardly rose from his seat on the side and moved to one of the places of honor facing the revenue officer. The Tehsildar now, for the first time, looked with interest at Azmat. "You must, in fact, be the young master of Dunyapur, Mian Azmat Gurmani." Conscious of the eyes upon him, which seemed amused and unsympathetic, Azmat began a long-winded description of his recent movements. "Yes, I've come to take control of the farm. I've just come from America. I was at school there for a number of years, though I came back every summer." The Tehsildar cut him off. "I see, most welcome, I see. So, Chaudhary Salim, how are your crops? All is well?" "With your blessings," responded Salim, lowering his eyes piously, as if right there receiving the blessings of the Tehsildar. The peon brought mixed tea in small, crudely made cups with a rose design, and also a little plate of biscuits. He served Azmat first, and when Azmat proffered the biscuits, the Tehsildar said in English, "Please, you take some, I take after you." He even put another biscuit onto Azmat's plate. "Have more," he said in English. One of the men sitting on the chairs, backed up against the wall, asked, "Are you then the son of Mr. K.K. Gurmani?" The Tehsildar gestured. "This is Mr. Aftab Varej, whose uncle is a leading advocate of Kanpur and our member of Punjab Assembly." Varej leaned forward and shook Azmat's hand. The Tehsildar removed an imported cigarette from a box lying on the table and snapped open a trick lighter shaped like a tiny pistol. "Do you smoke?" Azmat declined. Fixing his eyes on Azmat, the Tehsildar gulped the smoke greedily, held it, allowed trickles to escape his mouth, and inhaled it up again up his nose, a cycle. His eyes blazed with interest. As if he had come to some decision, he stubbed the full cigarette on the ashtray, excused himself, and went into the improvised toilet at the end of the room. Because the walls didn't reach to the ceiling, the bystanders could hear him moving about, then silence and more silence. "Should I come give you a little hand? I'd love to do that for you," called Varej. "If you were really coming, you wouldn't ask first," riposted the Tehsildar over the wall. I'll also translate this into Punjabi because it's very funny, although a little bit crude. This actually happened. I was in this Tehsildar's office, and this guy who was sitting there said, so we went into the toilet and we could all hear him, but nothing was happening in there. So finally he said, the Varej guy, this MPI, said, "Aun, aun." And the Tehsildar said, "Aan aale pooch ke nahi aunde." Excuse me, that was rather rude. They heard him pissing, and then the Tehsildar resumed his desk. Azmat felt this too as an insult. Awkwardly speaking up, he said, "I'm sorry to bother you, but I've come because I need the land revenue records for Dunyapur, everything from the last 10 years. Mr. Varej leaned forward, said, "Oh, but those records have been lost in the 81 floods, not to mention the termites. Look over there, look at the state of things." Moldering, dog-eared papers bound up with cloth stood in teetering piles along the walls behind the Tehsildar. "Absolute crime," agreed the Tehsildar. "Should I have one of my men come and help with the search?" "It's hopeless. You'll have to get the duplicates from Lahore, but I warn you, the situation is worse than here. What you really should do is get Chaudhary Salim to make up a rough list of your holdings, and then we'll work on that and see what we can find." He turned to Varej and began discussing something about a new watercourse, very apparently having finished with Azmat, who finally stood up and said he must go.
Thank you, Daniel. One of the things that listening to you I was reminded of was how much I really admire in your work. They're not these sort of huge fireworks, but they're sort of quiet detonations all over the page. And there are ways in which you give us characters just by a little detail. I mean, in that it was full of them. One of my favorite was the man with a trick lighter shaped like a tiny pistol, and you think, that tells me what I need to know about this guy. And it's a very effective and way of getting characterization across, that we don't have sort of huge bits of dialogue and huge bits of sort of description. And of course, sorry.
You can finish. Well, I think that, no, exactly. I'll answer this part and then you can do the next part. Yeah. That's really interesting. And I think that's one of the really most fun and also most complicated part of the craft of writing is what's left unsaid, which is what you're speaking about. I mean, fiction is, you know, when you're writing it, and also when you're reading it. When you're writing it, I think fiction is defined by sort of the absences as much as by what's present on the page, because it's such an intense process of selection, you know, that you leave out so much, and so much has to be implied. And I think that's one of the really fun things about fiction and about writing fiction, is that you're creating this world, but it's all sort of smoke and mirrors, because what you're doing is, you know, putting a little piece here and a little piece here, and then letting the reader with his experience and knowledge fill in those parts. And that's what makes reading such a collaborative and active process, that, you know, you don't know what that tehsildar looks like, but you've seen a guy with a trick lighter, and so you, in your mind, it's not going to be what was in my mind. I've just given you little indications, and then you, very actively working upon this, are going to make those other pieces. And this is, of course, why, you know, TV rots your brain, for example, because TV doesn't require you to do any of that. You know, TV, you just sit there and sort of, you know, eat your potato chips, and the whole thing happens to you. Whereas fiction, you have to work on it. You know, you're the guy who's doing half the work or more, and so it's better for you. Read more fiction.
Well, it reminds me, sort of taking that from the other angle, when the movie of The English Patient was made, Charlie Rose was interviewing the director, Anthony Minghella, and the writer of the book on which the movie was based, Mike Lundaccio. And rather complainingly, Anthony Minghella said, well, you know, for Mike Lundaccio to write about the desert, he gives you two perfect lines of atmosphere and description, whereas I actually have to take my film crew to the desert. And so it's
exactly.
It's all there. But I know you work across forms. I think I once heard you say that originally you thought of yourself as a poet before you were a short story writer.
Very much so. Yeah.
And I know you've sort of, we've seen the short story collection first, then you had a poem in the Granta Pakistan issue. I know you're working on a novel now. I wonder whether the sort of absences and presences you were talking about, the things that are on the page as opposed to the things we as the reader create, does that shift across form? Is there more? Does a novel leave space for more presence and less absence?
Yeah, that's really interesting. Look, I don't know, because I'm just figuring out this whole novel thing. I've never written one before. Clearly, I'm not sure, because I think we don't want to sort of confuse texture, which is these absences, presences thing,
right.
And having sort of running room, which means that, you know, in a novel you can have him, you know, Mr. X can go off and have a vacation in the Caribbean, and it's not that relevant to the theme at hand, but you can indulge yourself in this way, because of course, you know, as a writer, sometimes you're just in a mood to send your guy to the Caribbean, and when you're doing a short story, you can't send him to the Caribbean, because, you know, you've got to have that very straight narrative arc from A to Z, or B, depending on the story. So in answer to your question, I think I would distinguish it. I would say that the absences, presences thing is just, that's the nature of fiction, and it doesn't matter whether it's short story or a novel. The question is more complex and interesting with regard to poetry, because in poetry there's not, generally isn't a narrative in the same way. That's another long discussion, but there is a discussion to be had.
Do sentences work differently in a short story or a novel? I mean, are you aware in some sense that, I mean, the novel is often talked of as being a baggier form. And of course, your sentences are anything but baggy. And I wonder whether, and actually, I mean, I love the novel form, of course. I have to sort of.
I think you should be answering this. You're the one who's written about seven novels.
Well, but now that you're working on, I do wonder, does, one of the things with short stories, you put something in page one, and it can resonate through to the end of the story. You can expect the reader to keep in their memory all the details. Whereas with a novel, if you want an image to work by the end, you can't just have it at the beginning and at the end. It has to be sort of returned to at various points. And I wonder whether it means that, are the sentences constructed differently? Is there a different tension, less, more, between
that's
forms?
Interesting. First of all, I mean, my immediate response would be that, you know, the form is related to the material, so that you can't really talk about the form of short story writing or the form of novel story. You almost, I mean, if done properly, the form will be different depending on what you're writing about. Mm-hmm. That's true. So that would say one thing. But I think also what you're saying about resonances, that clearly is true, just because we're talking about such a different time period within which the piece will be read. I mean, so clearly, if you're that emphasis has to be different. If you're doing a novel, you know this mm-hmm. much better than I do. But if you're doing a novel, obviously you're going to have to sort of give the reader more of a hint about exactly what the hell this thing is, right. If you're going to refer back clearly.
One of the things that I hadn't really thought about in the short story collection only came to mind when you and I were talking earlier this year, or last year. There has been no earlier this year. One of your publishers, who was publishing your book in translation, had decided to rearrange the sequence of your stories. And I don't know about all of you, but on occasion I have been guilty of picking up a collection of short stories, and rather than reading it in the sequence that's there, I look at the table of contents, I think, I don't have that much time, I'll read the shorter story. Now I have more time, I'll read the longer. And of course, when I spoke to you and I saw, you know, when you said, I spend a very long time thinking about that sequence, I suddenly felt, you know, very small. And I realized I'd never thought about sequencing a short story collection. Can you talk with, in Other Rooms, Other Wonders, what went through your mind?
Look, you know, ideally, except for horrible people like Kamala. You read it from beginning to end, wrapped.
And I read yours from beginning to end.
Don't leave your couch until it's over, damn it. But assuming that you do that, or at least you're allowed to go and have a pizza in the middle. Yeah. Obviously, one thinks about, you know, I thought about it, especially because it was sold as a connected collection. I mean, I was hoping that the thing would be sort of more than just a bunch of short stories that happened to be lying in my drawer and they were thrown into a basket. Mm-hmm. So they're clearly, I mean, I not only was conscious of this as I was writing the stories, but I actually rewrote some of the stories in order to create this sort of larger narrative arc in the stories. There obviously is this some obvious, there's no rational, I can't say like, there's no rational for it. It's an emotional curve, you know, in which the first story was sort of to grab you by the lapels and make you keep reading, but also had a certain, you know, it's attractive in one way. Mm. And then at the end, of course, you want to have a sort of dying fall, as they say.
Yeah.
And so I certainly aimed for that with the last story. Mm. And then the other thing is that the story that I thought was least good, I buried it in the middle.
Well, that's good to know, because actually my two favorite stories are the first and the last, and about being a spoiled man. I thought, oh, that's brilliant, because you start off on this completely brilliant high, and then you end up in a very different, as you say, the dying fall. But again, sort of, you leave it in sort of this sort of sense of, oh my God, that was completely amazing. I'm not saying I didn't like the other stories.
It's okay.
I asked your wife earlier, I said, tell me a difficult question to ask Dania.
Oh dear.
Which is always a question any interlocutor should do, is get hold of the spouse. And she said, ask him about the agony of writing, because he doesn't talk about that. But actually, I was struck earlier in the first answer you gave, you said something about that's what makes writing both fun and complicated. And it is, you know, yesterday in your session, you talked about the play.
Yeah.
And of course, it's these two things don't cancel each other out, the play and the agony. So can you talk about the play and the agony?
Well, I mean, first of all, writing is like childbirth. I've never experienced given birth, but it's like that, in that apparently one is designed by nature so that the pain is all forgotten at the end,
right?
And only the pleasure remains in the mind, more or less. But you know, as, you know, clearly, there. I mean, writing is sort of a manic depressive activity, in that one, you know, there are moments, and this will be about the same piece of work in my case. There'll be moments when I'll feel the kind of despair that you feel, you know, only like when your sort of girlfriend leaves you or something like that. I mean, it's at that level, and because it's so fundamental, you think, I am a rotten, terrible person, I'm useless, I'm nothing. And then 2 days later, you'll be reading the same thing and sort of thinking, my God, I'm a bloody genius. This is incredible. Who is this guy? So that's all sort of bound up, you know, So obviously there is this tremendous, I think good writing has to be playful, you know, because we're in the process of entertaining people. That's what we do. And, you know, being, it's all, I mean, even writers who are thought of as gloomy, like, I mean, who, I mean, for example, to give a bad example, would be Kafka, who's, you know, seems it's said to be dark or whatever, but in the texture of it is hilarious. I mean, he's very, very funny. Mm. And similarly, I think that in my work, when I'm doing it, I think I need to charge myself up to the point as I'm in the process of writing, where I'm sort of like, you know, dancing on the keyboard. It's almost like playing piano. You're sort of thinking, trung, 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 you know, and having fun with it. And that's a necessary part of the process. But then the sort of the judgment that one starts judging oneself, and of course, then you often think this is terrible. And then I've come to moments of profound despair. Entirely out of proportion with the importance of the activity. I mean, I'm only writing stories.
And now a novel. Will you tell us a little about the novel you're working on now?
Yeah, I will. I'm working on something set entirely in New York, without any Pakistani characters in it, and without quite consciously, I'm not going to allow the word Pakistan to appear in the book. And it's about, it's, you know, it's it, every book is basically, there has to be a girl and a guy in a book, or a guy and a guy and a girl, whatever. So of course there's a love story. Without that, fiction is almost impossible. but more than that, it's a story about money, and it's an attempt to sort of consider the way in which money, sort of how fundamental money and things are to our being and our character. I remember when I was younger, I had an uncle, or I called him uncle. He wasn't really my uncle, and I was sort of saying something about money, you know, who needs money or whatever. And he said, "Don't ever say that, because money is the thing that most people give their whole lives for, and most people spend their lives toiling to have enough of it to put together some bloody food in their mouth. So don't badmouth this stuff." And I think that I'd like to try to approach. And sort of to approach that subject in that way, to really come to, you know, to consider how fundamental money is the ways in which we make and unmake our lives.
Mm-hmm. Now, I know you talked about this yesterday, but I think a lot of people who are here probably weren't there yesterday. There was at one point two novels on the go.
Exactly. I was writing a novel I was writing a novel set in Lahore in the 70s, which is when I was a kid there, and for me, and I bet for about half this audience, you know, the 70s was sort of the golden era, and the moral rot had not yet set in, or was just starting to set in. I was indulging my desire to dabble and play in that sunny period. Mm-hmm. And then at some point, this other story, my mother had passed away, and she used to live in New York. And this other subject has kept pressing itself upon me. You know, I had this strong desire to sort of go back and to live in Lahore. I mean, sorry, Lahore. Live in New York and to be in that place and to write about those restaurants and that the way the streets look in the morning when it's just been watered and, you know, that kind of thing. And I kept fighting it. You know, which is what one does, because you think, oh God, I can't do that. I've got to finish this bloody thing that I'm on. And then at some point, I just succumbed. And it was lovely, that moment when I said to myself, you know, it's okay, just do it, it's not a problem.
Yeah.
So that's what happened.
There was a moment yesterday when you were referred to, I think entirely erroneously, as an expat. And even as this, you know, claim was made about you, I was thinking, is she saying he's an expat when he's in Pakistan, or is she saying he's an expat when he's in America? Because, of course, you are an expat in neither. You are of both places. But I wonder, as a writer, so you've written one collection set in Pakistan, now you're working on a novel set in America. Do you feel, when you're writing about these worlds, do you feel yourself equally an insider or outsider to both the worlds when you write about them?
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, it depends on what. Clearly, you know, when I'm writing about Nawabuddin Electrician, he's less, you know, part of my everyday world than, you know, a lawyer in New York City, because I used to be a lawyer in New York City, so I've actually been inside that skin. I write stories, my mother owned a farm in Wisconsin, and I've written a number of stories set in Wisconsin about the farm people there. And in that case, I think I feel equally or even more distant from those from the characters that I'm describing, because you know, I've lived very intimately with the people at my farm, whereas my relations in, with those people in Wisconsin has been less close. So it's not really about which country it is, because I think I'm pretty much completely comfortable in both, but rather it's about my relation to the individual characters.
Right. I was asked a question today, which I'm going to ask you before we hand it over to the audience for their questions, which was, why do writers come to festivals?
Why do writers? Oh, for the adulation, of course.
There you go, all right. So it's time for some adulation or to prove him wrong in some tremendously
really
harsh
snippy
criticism. So could we have questions if people would raise their hand, the lady in the front row? Is there a mic going around for... There's a mic coming around. It's a pretty big hall, so you'd probably need to use that.
I've tried my hand at writing. In fact,
I think you need to speak up into it. Yeah.
I've tried my hand at writing. In fact, I had a story, you know, a concept for a story in my head, and I started to write it, and the first two chapters just came really easily, and then you know, you sit there and you get stumped, and you don't know what to do with the rest of the chapters 3 and 4, although you know how it's going to end. So, you know, some parts in writing are really easy to do, and some parts you just don't know what's going to happen next. And I was just wondering, do you ever experience this? And if so, what do you do about
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. No, that's, I think, very much part of the process. What generally happens to me is that, you know, you come in, you've got this great idea, this is going to be so easy. And then you sort of get whacked into about, you know, a third of the way through, and then you just totally run into a brick wall, and you're like disgusted, and you're never going to be able to write again about anything, not just about this thing. But then at the same time, you've got this ending, which is the moment I know the story is going to, I'm going to make it, is when I get the ending. And the ending is always the moment. It's like, it's beginnings and endings are like writing poetry in that they demand inspiration. With beginnings and endings, there has to be that eureka moment where you're like, bang, and it comes, and then you know. When it's in the beginning, you know, that's where the story begins. That's the germ. Generally.
Yeah.
And at the end, of course, you're about a third of the way through, and you, as you say, you get the ending. And then that's when you have to become a soldier, you know, and you just have to tromp through, and you have to trust yourself and just grind it out. That's just part of the process. At least for me, that's just part of the process. Yeah. You have to do that grunt work.
If I can just add a little thing to that, there's a little thing I've cut out and pasted on my desk, which is Alan Bennett talking about his play, The Habit of Art, which is about Auden, W.H. Auden. And there's a line he gives Auden, where Auden says, the most important thing for a writer is will. Not talent, not love, not originality, though of course you hope you have some of these things, but will. And I think that's just it, to be able to get past that, when you come to the end of that chapter 2,
Yeah.
Do you have the will to write chapter 3?
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you.
Other questions? Second row, and then we'll move to the first row here.
Okay, Daniel, how far have themes in your life affected the themes in your work? And in case they have, then have you ever noticed it becoming a focus, or has it been at the sidelines?
My life doesn't really have themes. You know, my life is, it's, I mean, no, nobody's life has a
actually,
theme.
Actually, when I say themes, I mean the events or situations that you have faced
fair
in
enough.
Life.
Fair
and
enough.
How far they have affected your work.
Okay. Well, my family would have you know that all of it is completely made up. joking. Obviously, when you're writing, there are some cases where you actually have to sort of blur the outline because it quite closely conforms with your own experience, and there are other cases in which it's completely made up, and you know that's the spectrum. And at least in my work, and I suspect in everybody's work, that's the way it happens.
Second row, and then move.
I'm going to ask you something about your characters, because the traditional relationship between the landlord and the people who work on the farm, there's a distance. But the way you get into your characters, was it observation? Was there a thorough study? Were you really that close to them? Because you were close to them. You described them. And the way you describe your thought process, their, you know, everything, yeah. basically. There's very, it's detailed. That's not a traditional landlord yeah. farm worker well, relationship.
Yep, yep. Well, remember, you see, I was in a somewhat unique position in that, you know, most people who run farms, they've sort of grown up with it, you know, and so, and they've been there all their lives. And so they have these sort of, you don't have to like study the animal, you know, of the Nawabdin, because you already know the animal, you know, in sort of just by, it's by osmosis into your pores. I was this completely clueless 23-year-old or whatever I was, who showed up at this place and had to figure it out from, you know, scratch. And therefore, I had to study these guys quite consciously. And I, at the time, I mean, I was writing a lot at the time, and there was a part of my mind that was always thinking, someday you're going to write about these guys. They're just way too interesting to be let just to wither away on the vine. So there was, I mean, right from the beginning, I think there was a consciousness that, you know, when you see, like that thing I said about, aanale puchke nahi aande, you know, that was, I actually stored that away somewhere in my brain thinking, that is delicious, I have to use that. So what I'm saying is that there was quite a, because I came from outside, I had to study these guys very closely.
Hello? What's the key to writing a good story?
What is the?
The key to writing a good story.
The key? Ooh, that's a hard one. I'm going to let you start with that.
I haven't written a really good story. You have, so you...
What is the key to writing a very good story? There are a number of keys to writing a good story, I suppose. But I think that the one thing you can't write a good story without is good texture. If the actual line by line stuff is entertaining and sort of funny, and you know, it has to be both funny and profound and all those things, then I think even though the story itself may be kind of weak and pathetic, usually at least the reader will give you quite a bit of credit, just saying, all right, it's fun. So maybe that's it. Maybe the key is you have to entertain, and the way to entertain, and I do think that very deeply, you have to entertain. And the key to entertainment, I think, is generally starts with texture.
Other questions at the back? People at the back, Ahmed Rashid.
Yeah. Danielle, I was wondering, you know, this explosion in Pakistani young writers like yourself and Kamla, Mohsen, Hanif. Why is it, why do you think it's happening now? Do you relate it at all to the political upheaval that the country is facing? Questions of identity, of poverty, of, you know, all the issues that beset us right now. Why do you think this explosion is happening 64 years after partition?
Well, I mean, first of all, let's not forget that, you know, there were these wonderful writers. I mean, thank you. There were these wonderful writers before us, like Salah Suleri and so on. We have our elders. Two, I think that there's a generation of people because clearly in Urdu and Punjabi and in these other languages there have been many more wonderful writers. It's just that I, for one, don't know about them. But I think that we're a whole generation of people who sort of went abroad, got educated abroad, and we're literate in a different way. I mean, and I'd love you to talk to this too. Our elders were, you know, we had elders who were very literate, but they weren't comfortable in their skins in the West the way we are, and they didn't have that sort of that sort of tactile understanding that we inhabit the stuff we read, the Western literature. Because I think those guys always were more outside of it. So there are many responses to that. Among which would be that, look, there are only three or four of us or five of us, whatever, and that's hardly a sort of enough to call us, you know, a huge literary movement or anything like that.
I'm going to do what any good Desi girl will do, which is to repeat what my mother said, which is in a session earlier. One thing actually she brought up, which is quite interesting, is that, and she was talking about this really in relation to the poet Maki Qureshi, and Maki reading Derek Walcott for the first time and having the sense of, oh, you know, I can, sort of a sense of familiarity. I think if you were growing up, say, in the 50s or 60s in Pakistan, what was your model for the kind of English language novel or short story you could write? I think that's also sort of a part to look at in there, that since sort of certainly post-Midnight's Children, That we don't, I mean, I don't think either Danial or I or anyone of our generation would think twice about being Pakistanis. Danial, of course, is also American, but being Pakistanis, writing about Pakistan in an English language novel, a short story, I mean, that there's nothing odd about it to us. I think if you were a Pakistani writer in the 60s, it would be a bit odd. I mean, how would you do it? Of course, Zulfikar Ghosh is here, who was, you know, really, I think, the first in, I would say, in post independent in Pakistan to really do that. But it was that whole question of how is it done was that first stumbling block, which is just not any kind of issue at all.
That's right, yeah. I mean, I think it's easy now to forget, for example, how revolutionary Midnight's Children was. You know, I mean, now on rereading, my opinion of it has changed, but at the time, I was just completely blown away by it. And it was, and you're right, it was the possibility, you can do this stuff, you know. And so, I mean, for us, it's sort of like, you know, you have the elder sister and the younger sister, and the elder sister, like, never gets to go anywhere and has to stay home until she's 18 and can't drive the car and so on and so forth. And then the younger sister, very unfairly, is sort of cruising around on her own at 14 because the elder sister has kind of made this space for it. Yeah. So I think we're kind of in that position.
So we're thanking our elder sisters here.
Yeah, exactly.
Next question.
Hi, I just wanted to ask about the journey toward The New Yorker.
Yep.
As stated earlier, it's a huge honor and many congratulations. But how did that come about? Was it through an agent? Did they approach you? Mm-mm. What was that journey?
It was weird. I published one story, the one about the Paris story, Our Lady of Paris, in this sort of semi-obscure literary magazine. And absolutely out of the blue, and then it died without a ripple. I mean, and I was just so overjoyed to get published at all. I couldn't believe this happened to me. And then suddenly about 2 years later, I got approached by a publisher, and they'd happened to see it somewhere and said, and then through that I got an agent. And then the agent just took over. I don't even hear about it. He just, you know, when the New Yorker acceptances happen, he just calls me up and says, yeah, he doesn't tell me he's submitting them, and I don't know what the alchemy is by which he bedazzles whatever the guy's name is.
I think he showed them the stories. I said, I think he showed them the stories, and that was the alchemy. Yes, at the back.
I don't know whether you write for yourself or the audience.
I'm sorry?
Do you write for yourself or for the audience?
Oh, obviously for the audience. You know, it's, I mean, I write, I enjoy the process of writing. I love writing. And it's, you know, that when I'm in the act of writing, I feel more alive than I do ever at any other time, if it's going well. But you know, I mean, ultimately the whole point is that, you know, you guys go out and read this stuff, and I get to play and make these lovely little puzzles, or I hope they're lovely, and then you guys get to read them, and I get pleasure out of the thought of you guys reading them, and, you know, that's so it's both. But certainly without an audience, the whole thing would be meaningless. Yeah.
Someone here? If other people have questions, just raise your hands now so I can see them, so I can direct people over to you.
In short stories, there's like the art of narration is very, very crucial to here. Yeah. In short stories, you do know that, you would obviously know that the art of narration is very crucial, and there's a lot of techniques and tricks that you can work with, and like free and direct discourse or the stream of consciousness technique, all of those things. In Pakistani literature, a lot is taken away with the portrayal of Pakistani culture and the imagery and all of that. How do you compromise in trying to work with short stories about Pakistani culture so that you adequately portray the culture as well as work with narration as a writer?
I'll sort of try to entangle to give my understanding of what you asked, which is the relationship between the. Could you help me on this? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear properly.
Okay. Go on. So there's the narrative.
Right.
You'll tell me if I'm doing this correctly. So there's the art of narration, there's getting the story across, but then I think the question was that if you're writing about Pakistan, there's a lot in a lot of Pakistani fiction about local color, I guess would be the phrase for it, sort of the Are you saying that you're writing towards an audience that possibly a large part of your audience may not know the world you're writing about?
Yes,
so I see. Okay,
as
good,
a writer,
good.
Do you feel, you're spending a lot of time
That's
adding local
actually.
Color?
Because most of my audience is not in Pakistan, but is abroad. And so clearly, it's a very different thing when I describe it for you guys and when I describe it for a guy in New York. And so that's really interesting. I sort of write it at the level where I would understand it myself. And I guess I'm not really conscious of trying to, I mean, you can't explain, first of all. If you're explaining, you're dead. You're dead in that it's not going to succeed. But at times you do have to just put in a little touch of something because otherwise they're not going to understand in the West. So there is some compromise that has to be made to sort of perfect, if it's integrity or whatever you want to call it, mm-hmm. In which you don't explain at all.
Do you have a question? No, I mean, Daniel, you know, okay. Any other questions? I think we have time for about two more since we started a little late. Anyone?
Don't all say it at once.
Anyone? There's someone in there.
Come on, there we go.
Okay, in the second row.
You.
Oh, and the lady in the second row.
With the fawn color.
Second row. This one.
Thank you. Do you focus more when writing?
Where are you? I don't have my glasses here. Ah, there you go.
When you're writing a short story, do you focus more on technique or on like the general arc of the story? Are you a big picture or a little picture writer? Because does the germ of a story come from a single sentence or an actual event?
First of all, I mean, it's you can't think of it as a mechanical process. It's a chemical process. The story and the arc of the story, all of that is sort of bound together into this sort of as you're experiencing the writing of it. It's a sort of this chemical compound that's sort of transforming as in your mind So there's a kind of an organic development. It's organic. But clearly, I mean, for me, the process is that there's one little piece that I carry around a piece of paper, and something somebody said, it may be, the way a man I've seen looked, or, any one of a number of things, and that'll sort of sit in my back of my mind for a long time and sort of start accreting a story around it, and then so that's how it works for me.
Okay. And the second, the final question.
Yes, hi. Out of the three forms that you've written in, poetry, short stories, and novel, which one do you enjoy the most, and why?
I certainly believe that poetry is the highest form. I mean, I believe in a hierarchy. I think that the most elegant and refined form is poetry, and then short stories, and then least of all, the novel.
I'm going to beat him up after this.
my
I agree with him, but I'd still beat him up.
The process is so different that you really can't compare. Say, I enjoy this more, I enjoy that more. Writing, they say about poets, that poets are people who spend their lives standing around in rainstorms, hoping to get hit by lightning. And that's sort of how writing poetry is. Whereas with prose, you can sort of grind it out. You put in the meat and at the other end comes out sausage. It's easier to do. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you to Daniel Moinuddin. Could we have a round of applause?
Thank you. And thank you, Kamala.